where the rubber always meets the road, I think. Actually, I'm not even sure what that means.
Heartland Newsfeed Radio Network, live at heartlandnewsfeed.com.
Christina Tobin on her update on the UCLA censorship lawsuit that they had. She wanted to have something to say about that. Well, what are you going to tell us about it today? Good morning, Christina. How are you?
Hi. Good morning, Ernie. How are you today?
I'm more than a wonderful. And you?
I'm doing really well. Thank you.
Well, tell me where we are on that. I want to get into what your plans are for 2020, but before we get to that, let's see, you know, we'll kind of tie up some loose ends on how they're screwing you in the last election and the one before that and the one before that and the one before that. So go ahead and tell me what's up with your UCLA lawsuit.
Oh, shit. I mean, for people who are not aware of the situation, I mean, you were there in 2014, you know, free and equal elections. We're quite well known for our presidential debates we've held in 08, 12, 16, and we plan to hold in 20, 24, and so on as well. We launched our first annual United We Stand concert back in 2014. It was slated at UCLA's Poly Pavilion, holds 10,000 people. And 5 days before the event, UCLA wrongfully canceled the event. They stifled free speech, and so we have sued them, Free and Equal Elections, for freedom of speech violation, really a breach of contract. And we have a hearing scheduled at the end of June. So there's a lot more to it. I've been going to all the depositions, most of them. And definitely what UCLA did was really wrong.
Well, I mean, what was their excuse? All right. Explain to people what was planned, what happened, who was to perform, and what they planned on doing, and they offered back and forth. I mean, it was just, and who is behind it, and why, and what their argument is now, and we would never, I mean, you know, so give me the spiel. You got like 4 minutes to, you know, do your elevator's pitch.
Well, yeah, I haven't really gone public about this in almost 5 years now. This has been, and we had Public Enemy slated as our headliner, you know, Rock and Roll Hall of Famer Chuck D, to Larry King, to Dennis Kucinich, to Marianne Williamson, to founding members of Wu-Tang Clan, to Brother Ali, Immortal Technique. I mean, the list goes on and on. Sean Stone, yourself, Ernie. I mean, it's just so many beautiful people. And what happened was about 3 months out from the event, I noticed a lot of tension coming in directly from the dean, Robert Maples, at the time of UCLA. I spoke in front of a group of about 100 student group leaders on campus and got a standing applause, and they all wanted to support a United We Stand concert at UCLA on May 10, 2014. And as we were getting closer to the event, they started dropping off one by one, coming to us, you know, a lot of them giving us hugs and saying their advisors told them not to support this event, of which some of them said their advisors even said the dean, Robert Maples, had instructed the advisors not to support the event. That was very troublesome for me to hear. Unfortunately, I could not change the venue because we had already rescheduled the event at UCLA from fall to spring because we had hoped it would become an educational event and become, less expensive to have the event there, but that didn't work out. So we had to hold it there. Can't change it twice, location or time, that's for sure. So as we got closer to the event, 5 days out, 7 days out, we sold thousands of tickets. And as soon as we announced Chuck D, a Public Enemy, was to come on campus, that's when the cancellation happened, hours after. The buzz was huge on campus. The student group leaders were getting excited. It was really hostile what UCLA did. Now, we had an angel funder who wired $90,000 on time to UCLA 5 days out, and they still canceled it. What happened, Ernie, that morning at around 8:09 a.m., we had a noon deadline. She was to wire the $90,000, and she gives me a call and says the UCLA rep, who's in charge of the Poly Pavilion, Rich Mylan, he called her at least two times the morning of according to her, trying to talk her out of sending the money. He attacked my character, saying he felt I wasn't capable of putting on this event. These are the exact things that she said at a deposition that I was at a couple weeks ago. In support of free and equal elections, she found it to be odd. She called me and was not happy about it, and she initiated a three-way call with the UCLA rep after the 12 o'clock noon deadline. The phone records show it around 12:20 or so. And so we had the three-way call, and he agreed with her on the call that if she wired the money by the end of the business day, the show would go on. In the deposition, she stated that she strongly recalled that it was end of business day. She wired the $90,000, not even 20 minutes after the call. I'm sending an email to UCLA. Hey, she sent the $90K. I see an email come in saying the show has been canceled. I mean, what they did was just a complete breach of contract.
Well, who was they? I mean, you know, when you're talking about it, was it the dean? Was it come on high? Was it, you know, and who and why? And, you know, we're going to find out when we come back. Christina Tobin. This is how it's done. I mean, you know, we went through the Lovelution years and how things are, and you record it. And then all the video goes away. I don't remember that. Memory hole. That never happened. Yeah. Well, we're going to find out, Christina.
From the fourth letter of Captain Mark. Landlubbers are conditioned to believe that the originators of an idea deserve exclusive rights to it, but these innovators are nothing but privateers, granted a monopoly by the Crown. Potential inventors are restricted from using their own property and forced to navigate a wilderness of prohibited ideas. These patterned monopolies are intellectual colonization. This alliance of means between the Crown and the privateers is not an alignment of ends. Both collude to establish a permission culture, in which everyone second-guesses their own thoughts, never sure which ideas are permissible to develop. But their objectives are different. The Crown aims to cripple dissenting opinion, while privateers will only be satiated when all new ideas already fall under their monopoly. This scheme does not protect our information, but seizes it and denies us access. The future belongs to individuals who think, speak, and act freely to create and share without reservation. Join the conversation at piratswithoutborders.com.
Christina Tobin, skip to the end on this. We got a controversy with UCLA. You know, one thing that is of interest to, you know, some is that Janet Napolitano was governor. She was, you know, assistant attorney general under Reno in the Clinton administration. Then, excuse me. Then she was here in Arizona, then she became attorney general, then she became governor, and then from there she went to be Department of Homeland Security, and then in charge of the university system in California. And I'm going, okay, that was about this time, so I'm going, it's definitely political. You know, this is political. And so I'm wondering what the justification reasons were and what they're saying now in depositions and how, I mean, either they did or didn't get the money. They did or didn't cancel it. They did or didn't get in the way. They did or didn't. And I'm wondering why. What's their justification?
I would say that their justification, they're kind of just grasping. It's a tough one.
Well, they say something.
It's like a sideshow. That's kind of what I'm seeing.
Well, what are they saying? I mean, they're going, we didn't do it, didn't want to do it because we didn't do it. Or they say, no, Christina's lying, sack of snot, and that's not what happened. You know what? What are they saying?
I would say the only thing that they're trying to grasp onto is that we didn't have the insurance covered for the event. But when you look at all the email dialogue, when you have the witnesses in deposition, I mean, there's multiple emails and witnesses that it was very clear that once the venue was to be paid in full, which was $90,000, that we would pay the insurance, which was $16,000. And we even have a witness that's going to be giving a deposition saying, yeah, I pledged to pay the $16,000 for that insurance. I mean, nobody wants to put up $16,000 if you already have a sense that UCLA may cancel an event on the basis that they did, and you lose another $16,000, right?
Did you get your $90,000 back?
Well, initially, the UCLA rep told me that we free and equal elections wouldn't get it back, or we get part of it back, and that was just really not a nice thing to say. And I came back and said, well, you'll have to talk to the funder, because the wire came directly from her. She got the entire $90,000 back, but my sense is that if it came directly from free and equal elections, they would have kept most, if not all of it. That's what the, you know, the representative for Poly Pavilion had indicated to me, which was not a nice thing to hear, given the circumstances. So we have sued them for up to $1 million in arbitration. That's how the contract is. We could not do millions because it costs even more money. I think the damages, there's not even an amount that could be put onto it. The cost for arbitration fees alone are upwards of over $50,000 to $70,000.
Whoa!
That's not including legal fees. Fortunately, the backer of this lawsuit is an alumni of UCLA, and he was the initial backer that put up six figures to really ignite the spark of United We Stand in 14, as well as hundreds, if not more, of donors on our Indiegogo campaign. We raised well over $60,000, which the donations averaged around, I don't know, $20, $25 each. So, I mean, the people put up a lot of money, too. And, you know, I had a recent call with Dr. Ron Paul and Dennis Kucinich and Colin Cantrell of Nexus Earth, and Ron Paul and also Jim Cantrell of Vector Space, the co-founder of SpaceX. Ron Paul specifically said in that call, universities are the biggest threat. You know, they breed their own kind. And I have really experienced firsthand from within the university system that there is a lot of room for improvement, I think, is a nice
okay,
way
so
to
let's
put it.
Well, let's skip to the end. I keep asking the question, and I'm not getting an answer. Why?
Oh, sorry.
Why?
Well, I would say in a press release that we put out just a couple days ago, we stated that that the event, 5 days before the event, UCLA revoked the contract hours after they learned Rock and Roll Hall of Famer Chuck D, a public enemy, was scheduled to speak to the students on campus to help promote the event. So Chuck D actually came the following year and spoke on our stage at United We Stand, of which he said, I quote, Chuck D, our group is public enemy, and I've been talking to Christina Tobin for a while. Last year, we were slated to play at UCLA's Poly Pavilion, and I guess we all know what happened. If you don't know, just check in with Christina. We're down for the movement and the cause to wake people up, stated, you know, Chuck D of Public Enemy at our 2015 United We Stand concert. So that would be my guess, that the day after they canceled it, Ernie, they got a lot of backlash, you know, in the LA Weekly, LA Times. I mean, people could see what happened. I mean, with a lineup like what we had, you would think a university would embrace it. You know, Wu-Tang Clan, Immortal Technique, Public Enemy, Larry King. I mean, you know, go on and on. UCLA did not. They were hostile towards us. So the day after, we had an attorney contact them, and they messed up. They came back, and the first question they asked Ernie was, it's Public Enemy, Rich Milan, that is, of, you know, control of the Poly Pavilion, running that of UCLA. He asked, let me turn that off, sorry. He asked if Public Enemy was still performing at United We Stand. I said, no, because you canceled the event. Or, you know, we lost our deposit. And they came back, and Rich Milan said, well, now we can consider an educational event. You don't have a full band. I said, well, actually, we do have more full bands. That was just one of quite a few. And he just didn't give me a reason. And they dropped the price from $90,000 to $15,000 at the Poly Pavilion. But, you know, once you're written up in the media, which UCLA used their own Daily Bruin newspaper to attack my character, saying I failed to make payment on time, which was a lie, and didn't even quote my side of the story when I interviewed with them, that it was paid on time, and told them exactly what I told you. But in any case, I found it very challenging to raise money, Ernie. You know, when you have a canceled event and you have this cloud that's wrongly placed above you, like, it's hard to raise $15,000.
You know, this is, this is a good example of how reporters are selected out of the university newspapers. This is, they go from the university newspaper, that is their resume, and they go to these newspapers in large cities and so on, like here, there's a Republic, and we knew this and followed it through, and then finally we're old enough that some of these guys start retiring and they get parties and they talk about it and they, you know, write about it and their history of and so on. What they do is if they show their inclination to do what they're freaking told, just like the Bruin newspaper, they come out and they'll say this, they won't do that. Okay, all right, we got a job for you. You're doing what you're told. Boom. This guy, whoever wrote that story, I'll bet you if you look at it right now, look at where whoever wrote it, where is he at now? It's the L.A. Times, in Seattle, in San Diego. It's because they do what they're told. It is a testing ground. We've learned this. And, you know, they chose poorly because their down-the-hall dorm mate, you know, is just some engineering student that started his own blog and has got 10 times the audience writing his own thing, telling the truth about something. Competition.
Uncovering the secrets and exposing the lies. That's what the readers of FreedomsPhoenix.com get every day. FreedomsPhoenix.com constantly providing the information, the real news about government policies, and the real relationship we all have with the coercive government. The real condition of the economy, innovations in technology, breakthroughs in energy, health, and computer science. Learn the truth well before it's admitted to in the lamestream media. The corporate media, nothing more than distributors of government propaganda, but now there's an alternative. FreedomsPhoenix.com. Constant news updates on the issues that affect your life in the most important ways. With liberty and property under constant attack, FreedomsPhoenix.com provides the understanding behind the propaganda, and it encourages the participation of its readers. Go to FreedomsPhoenix.com. That's Freedoms with an S, Phoenix.com. FreedomsPhoenix.com. The revolution between the ears has already happened.
Come back.
It's time for Declare Your Independence with Ernest Hancock. To be a part of the show, call 602-264-2800.
Christina Tobin, freeandequal.org. Where she came to fame at first was she has a patron that's been really, you know, supportive. Ed Asner, an actor out of Hollywood. A lot of us are older. You remember him from a lot of different TV things. And he's been supportive of Christina, making sure she's getting out doing, you know, the work of the peoples. And it was, God, what was it? The 08 campaign, I think it was. They were doing presidential campaigns that they were, debates and so on, that they would include a lot of other third-party candidates. That was her sin. And what happened is Larry King co-hosted that with her, and they did it and had some of the third-party candidates on. And that is what the sin is that you have a real debate with real alternatives and other voices. And a lot of these, you know, they're on like the Libertarians, they're, you know, 50-state ballot status. You know, that doesn't seem to matter. You have other people that are popular. It doesn't matter. You have, and the reason we do the Trump report, how that came about for, God, it's going on almost 4 years. Oh, my God. You know, every week it was Dr. Frank Tamburi when he went to vote in, the 2000 election cycle. And it was one of the first, he's, you know, in Japan, going to medical school, he's becoming politically aware, he's doing a lot of different things, paying attention, and he goes down, and he goes to vote, and there's a, you know, like several other names up there for president. And he went, who the hell are these people? How come I've never heard of these guys? What's their deal? I'm here to vote right now. I never even heard of these guys. What the hell is going on? So then he was upset. Then he started looking at video and cases, and one of them was Ralph Nader, where he was uninvited and disinvited and got a ticket to go in to see the thing and kicked out and threatened arrest. And, I mean, he's like, he saw this documentary. He's like, who the hell is limiting our choice? What the heck? They're on. They're available. People want to hear them. They're being denied. And he's going, what is – so that's why – he was interested in your case. And I look at it and I'm just, it's just one more reason why I'm so disinterested in the process of voting for who's going to rule me kind of thing, certainly on a national level. There's many other ways of doing this, and one of the ways is pointing out what happens when you do it, like with Christina Tobin. Now, Christina, I know you want to, you know, freeandequal.org, you're not done, you have a goal, and we're going to hear from, and damn it, and 2020's coming up. Well, in light of all of this, you're still, you know, for democracy, and if it wasn't for you doing this and pressing this, it'd just be even a bigger farce. But can you unfarce it? I mean, what are you going to do?
Well, you know, we spoke during the break to wrap up the UCLA case. They have a hearing scheduled June 24th, up to 5 days. The whole goal is not only to win up to $1 million, have UCLA give a statement, that really clear.
What do you mean after 5 days? In June 24th, after 5 days, is it a five-day trial? What are you saying?
Up to 5 days is the hearing for arbitration.
Okay. Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, 5 days? Damn.
I know. There's a lot of witnesses. I think there's at least seven. So there's a lot of things that pre-recorded ahead of time. And in fact, the backer of this event and this case will be at the hearing to testify and live time as well. He's so amazing.
You know, that's another thing. These people that have been supportive, that are the crux of a lot of the testimony of this, have they been contacted by the university or other people wanting to shut up or anything?
Well, this person's not one to shut up, and he's also happens to be an alumni of UCLA that is standing up against what they did wrong.
Well, I mean, they've been contacted? Is somebody trying to explain it to him?
Oh, well, I mean, he's giving a deposition, so yeah, he knows what happened. That's why he supports us.
I know he knows what happened. I'm just saying, you know, there's somebody from the university going, come on, do you really want to do this? I mean,
not that I know of at all. It wouldn't even face a person of that caliber.
All right, so that's on your plate. Let's go ahead and, you know, that's going to be decided one way or another. And if you get some money, then that may be one thing.
And Ernie,
it's not get you money so you can do another event.
Well, that, and also to clear our name, and also to help others from being bullied by university systems. I hope and foresee Free and Equal Elections being in a position to help smaller entities from this happening to them. But that's really what I want this case to really have a national spotlight in, helping this from happening to others. But, you know, going to Ralph Nader, the whole uninvited to the party, I worked as his national ballot access coordinator in 08, you may recall.
Yeah.
And because of the team I built, the people around me, we were able to get him on the ballot in 45 states plus D.C. We didn't have enough money for all 50 states. But that's over 500,000 signatures. If you want to get on the ballot in all 50 states, it takes over 900,000 signatures to run as an independent for president, which means it probably is going to cost anywhere from 7 to 10 million or upwards to 20 million just to get on the ballot. If you file last minute, it's closer to 20 million. That's expensive. So that's one of many different hurdles of our electoral system, as well as the presidential debates you were talking about, the Commission on Presidential Debates, that current two-party, really one-party mainstream debate.
Yeah.
Gosh, Ralph taught me in 08. He was really a big spark in the creation of Free and Equal Elections, because it was a moment this light bulb went off in my head when he took me to the DNC, just him and I, to interview with a lot of the press there. And he said, Christina, you know, I could interview with every member of the press right now. I may put this in a book someday. And he said, I wouldn't reach but 3-5% of what the Commission on Presidential Debates reaches. And I'm like, no way. I'm like, what is the commission? I'm new to this, the Commission on Presidential Debates. And I learned, you know, it's run by the former chairs of the Democratic Republican Party. Another tool that the powers that be uses is, you know, the two-party system, the Commission on Presidential Debates, rigging the electoral system, like the ballot access, the voting machines, not having alternative voting methods. I mean, the list goes on, you know, into mainstream music and Hollywood and so on. But, to shift back towards the solutions, we're going to hold our first stop of our United We Stand tour this April 27th at Earth Day, actually Earth Week in Fort Wayne, Indiana. I'm really excited to be there. And the community has built it for us, Ernie. I mean, the stage, the production, 5-camera crew, local artists. I mean, it's the 14th annual Earth Week, and we're honored to be hosting that and also co-hosting with Heartland communities. So there's going to be a lot of, growing of food and learning permaculture and all of that, and having a beautiful event. It's the first stop of our tour this year.
Okay. Happening. Now, the tour is to do what? To promote what? Everybody gets to have a say to promote your tour of presidential debates. I mean, they're starting. You know, this stuff is starting. Hell, we already got a bunch of Democrats jockeying for who's not going to get elected or something. It's whoever comes out first. Never when Elizabeth Warren was one of the first in the starting block. Well, she ain't going to be it. I mean, it's never the first guys. It's always, you know, after they go through and pick and do the focus groups of that, and here comes the somebody. And
Ernie, so what's the tour? Reeling it in, like the tour of United We Stand. It's the spark and the kickoff of recognizing whether you have Dennis Kucinich, Jesse Ventura, Ron Paul, like all people I communicate with pretty regularly and more. We have to and we will unite and recognize that across the political spectrum, there are more ideas that we can agree on than not. And what our platform does, what separates it really from, I think, most if not any other platform, is that we welcome all ideas, nonviolent, peaceful ideas, across the political spectrum. You don't have to agree with each other, but let's have a voice. You know, our slogan's more voices, more choices. Now, what's going to evolve throughout this tour? I mean, I can already see the venue of Red Rocks opening for us. Velasco Theater wants us back in L.A. We're going to help. We're going to be launching our election system app, recognizing, Ernie, that every problem stems from having the wrong people in office. And we're going to launch.
It stems from having an office to put wrong people in.
We're going to launch our blockchain election system app. And I foresee blockchain voting will revolutionize our voting.
From the first letter of Dr. Idris Barber, I've healed many landlubbers, but could have healed countless more if they were willing to break the law to preserve themselves. The Crown required that I obey leeching privateers who didn't share my oath to do no harm. I was forbidden from discussing the treatments I knew patients needed. The Crown claims to protect landlubbers from bankrupting medical expenses, but only seduces them into begging for relief, while privateers monopolize the management of chronic illness. This royal alliance has constructed a medical hegemony that denies science, discredits alternative remedies, and mandates unwanted treatments, while callously ignoring the victims dying on waiting lists. They have produced a society increasingly addicted, impoverished, diseased, and suicidal. My conscientious objections and medical ambitions required not only seeing this cage, but leaving it. That's why I raised my black banner. Among pirates, the Crown's tantrums are irrelevant. You own your body without qualification. Open ocean medicine enables healers and customers to build a relationship of mutual consent. Prices decrease, quality increases, and physicians become as accessible as barbers. Customers determine their own medical care, whether that's experimental treatments, prohibited plants, controversial procedures, bootleg pharmaceuticals, or even the right to die. Any system of command and control is rejected. In time, artificial intelligence, nanotechnology, genetic engineering, and cybernetic prosthetics could take the human condition beyond our imagination. Medical augmentation could eliminate aging, enhance intelligence, and erase our fundamental physical limitations. With the Crown in our wake and the individual at the helm, we are free to pursue an unfettered life. Need decentralized solutions to centralized problems? Join the conversation at piratswithoutborders.com.
Freedom is the answer. What's the question?
I want to break free.
You're listening to Ernest Hancock.
I want to break free.
To break free. Yep. From those that, I don't know, won't let me be free and do what I want to do the way I want to do as long as I'm not bothering anybody else. I mean, what's up? Well, the problem is that it's not, you got the freedom to do whatever the hell I tell you to do. That's what it is. And this is permeating society around the world, this idea that they even can. And with the internet of everything, they can. They're going to manage us down to the what? And would, you know, ATM is just going to pick our presidential candidate. No, they'll just pick president. It's this AI here. It just said, you know, vote this way and walk this way. You know, I understand all the, you know, the concerns about this, but I want to, in the future, there could be blockchain voting gives me the opportunity to feel a little bit more secure about it. It has some secure. I mean, they'll screw with that too if they can. If they can, they will. But I'm what Christina is advocating for is: can we get some accuracy? Can we have some confidence in it? Can we bypass all the problems and start get back to the way it was supposed to be? And do you believe in the wisdom of the crowd? Well, a lot of times they don't. You know, that's what the Republic was all about. The Constitutional Republic is like, it doesn't matter what you vote. There are certain things you can't do to the individual. That's just the way it is. So, democracy, Republic, where's your line on that, Christina? You know, do you got one, or are you just all pure democracy?
I'm kind of demo public. I think that there's just a lot more alike between both than not, and it's kind of another divisive issue. People lean one or the other, and you know, just freedom is really what it comes down to. And I think, you know, it's interesting whether you believe in voting or not. I believe in peace, right? And so the only peaceful way that I can see us achieving a transparent system is, first and foremost, you know, replacing most, if not every member of Congress with accountable candidates. And there has to and will be an idea, a platform that will rise, that when it comes and hits the masses, nothing will get in its way. I mean, you go back to the American Revolution, it takes, what, only 3% of the people to back an idea. And so, you know, Free and Equal Elections, we're that umbrella group that brings together all the different, you know, far left, far right, independent groups and platforms of a variety of topics. In fact, we're working very closely with the creators of Standing Rock right now. I'll be out in Colorado in June, and they also did the documentary Awake, the story of Standing Rock. And I think that the indigenous energy of what they did at Standing Rock, standing up against fear of the system, and they overcame that with love and compassion. That's really the sort of energy we attract and want at Free and Equal Elections. But in any case, you know, blockchain voting, I think it's going to be for the next 10 years. It's going to be probably one of our best choices where it will, again, help revolutionize our voting system and bring about political transparency. I think something even better will come along 10 years, maybe less or more, give or take. But this seems to be the best option right now. So we're going to launch that on our United We Stand tour, and we're going to not only list every candidate running for office, these are third parties, independents, but we're also going to incorporate election reform experts, experts on different topics. We're going to help educate the masses because we have got to have an educated voter, right? We're going to inspire people to run for office, targeting the congressional races, and they can click there to run for office, click here to learn how to get on the ballot. You know, click here to volunteer to help a candidate. Click here to see how much money is being donated into each campaign so you know whether they're beholden to the powers that be or not. So online debates, that's what's going to evolve through the app. And it's going to teach people how blockchain works, where your voting is on the ledger. And, yeah, there's going to be some hiccups, more so in the coming year or years, not as many as the years evolve. And so that's really where we're at United We Stand, and we're going to have a lot of fun. You know, we're going to have, you know, the youth and the music and we the people. Ron Paul once said, if we're ever going to bring about revolutionary changes, two things will need to be involved.
Youth and music.
And music.
Well, this is, I can see where this is a threat. I can't imagine just letting this go because you're the tip of the spear on so many other efforts like that. It must be denied. And probably, I don't know, sooner or later, whenever you press on this hard enough, it creates direct competition that is controlled opposition by them. So there will be an alternative. I think in 2020, they can't not have a third party or a alternative or a more inclusive debate but they can't allow it to be done without them having ultimate control. So I see this coming, but they're, you're going to have to overcome a lot more than just UCLA. And I'm wondering what the game plan is. You think it's just going to be a grassroots up out in the hinterland of the county fair of here we, you know, all of a sudden, boom, here we are?
I do. Real change. Ed Asner, in one of our forums, he said real change begins from the bottom on up. And so here we go, Earth Week. We already have organizers in Colorado asking us to come there, movers and shakers, to do a leg of our United We Stand concert there. Velasco Theater, I should have mentioned earlier, even though UCLA canceled our 2014 United We Stand, Velasco Theater saved the day in L.A. They allowed us to, we booked the venue 5 hours before the event, and thousands of people still showed up. It was a bit of a miracle. The damages were done. The people were upset. I feel we're going to come back tenfold, hundredfold, no matter. Hopefully the arbitrator makes things right into June, but regardless, fighting the power. We've done what we can, and we'll leave it up to our council.
You know, there was one thing I want to get into the show before we end here. There was in 04, I remember we were at the Libertarian National Convention, Charles Goyette and I, in 04 in Atlanta. Mm-hmm. And Sheriff Richard Mack came up, and he was, doing some race in Utah, and it was going whatever. All of a sudden, there was an opportunity they had. It was called America's Candidate. You remember that? It was a reality show that they were following these eight candidates or something that they interviewed and whittled it down. Okay, you guys go out, and they gave them tasks. All right, do a rally, do a town hall, get some people, go get your people kind of. So Sheriff Mack, he has some people. He got people that support him, Patriot and Merca, and they were coming. It started building. It was a cable thing that they're going to run all the way through the 04 election cycle, and boom, they canceled it. And it was successful as far as, people paying attention, participating, it's going, and they go, oh, hell no, you did not get a permit for that, okay? So I can see that I remember it was the League of Women's Voters. We went up against them in the early 90s here in Arizona, and then you found out they're mostly men, that you're dealing with, and women did, doing what the hell they were told, and this candidate and that one and that shall not, and the head guy here in Arizona was a former staffer of a Republican congressman. I mean, okay, I get it. This is all crap. Well, we nailed them, and how it changed a lot of that from the League of Women Voters is that in their documents, it said they were bipartisan, not nonpartisan, bipartisan. They were there to promote the Republicans and Democrats as the choices. It was in their charter. And I'm going, look, how do they get a 501c3 when they're by their own documents are excluding everybody else? Somebody explain that to me. Boom, they're not it anymore. I'm going, yeah, that's what I thought. So they will morph and change and do whatever the hell to avoid exactly what you're trying to do. So every resistance you give them, every time you point out this stuff, every arbitration, every lawsuit, that's the value that you have, far as I'm concerned, is just outing and exposing what's really going on. That's why I'm supportive of this. It's just the farce of the whole damn thing. But if you're successful and you get other voices in that, at the very least, our criteria in my head is if you got enough states to give you enough electoral college votes to become president, you're eligible. That's as far as I'm concerned, that's it. Can you be president? All right, well, then you win. Get up there and say what's up. That, I don't know any other. Well, the percentage of the BS. Do you or do you not get? Then they start trying to limit you being able to get on the ballot. And it just keeps reversing back and back and back and back. And out in all this,
fight them all.
As we go through this whole thing, is Christina Tobin from, free state. So I'm just going freeandequal.com. United.
.org.
I'm sorry. freeandequal.org. Christina, stay in touch. I'm always interested to hear what's going on in this 2020 cycle. Be a coming. And what's your next event? The Indiana one?
Yeah, Fort Wayne, Indiana. Earth Week, United We Stand. First stop of the tour. And let's all remember that there are more of us than there are of them. And love is greater than...